This is the Cars.com best SUV for 2023, the 23 Jeep Grand Cherokee, which we at Cars.com bought a long-term test version of, and the Trailhawk 4xe model. Now, that means that it is the ultimate off-road version of the Grand Cherokee and the Trailhawk, and it's also a plug-in hybrid. That's the 4xe. But it's also a family vehicle, and not what most people think of when they think of the ultimate off-road Jeep. That is the 2023 Jeep Wrangler Rubicon in 20th anniversary trim, also a 4xe, also a plug-in hybrid. So both of these Jeeps can motor silently through the woods in electric mode, which is really something we wanted to experience. So we brought both of these here to Attica, Indiana, and the Badlands Off Road Park as part of the local Jeep Jamboree to put these two through their paces to actually see which one of them is the better off-roader in hybrid electric mode. But I can't do this by myself, so I'm gonna need someone to help me. Hey, Damon, what are you doing?
Oh, what? Nothing.
Wanna go wheeling?
Okay.
All right, let's go.
All right.
So we've actually driven both of the 4xe's now pretty extensively over the course of the last 2 days through the Badlands here in Attica, Indiana. And in my mind, it really comes down to one thing. You can have comfortable or you can have capable. I mean, they're both capable, they're both comfortable, but one focuses more on capability, the other focuses more on comfort. This one is the comfortable one. This is our long-term Grand Cherokee 4xe Trailhawk, and comfort really is the name of the game in this thing.
Yes, we would not be near as comfortable were we sitting in the Wrangler Rubicon right now.
No.
We would be shoulder to shoulder.
Yeah.
My knees would be jammed against the center console and outside. Yeah, the space of the Grand Cherokee is a key asset.
And the one thing that we did find made a huge difference on the trail was cooled seats.
Yes.
It's got
yes.
ventilated seats in this thing.
Which you got for the afternoon and I got for the morning when it was not as hot.
Well, you know, we traded. I gave you the opportunity.
Yes.
But yeah, I mean, the Wrangler's advantage is that it is extremely capable, especially in things like approach angle. You don't have much front overhang at all. So it's really easy to get to an obstacle, to go up an obstacle, no problem. This thing surprised everybody in terms of how well it did, however. The Grand Cherokee, its capability is astonishing, especially since you've got this electronic air suspension that raises the thing so that it actually has more ground clearance than a standard Rubicon.
Yeah, it was, so I drove this the better part of 3 hours coming down from Chicago to the off-road park here. And on the highway, save for a little bit of elevated road noise, maybe touch more wallowy suspension feel, it feels like your garden variety luxury crossover SUV. Very plush vehicle on the highway. But when I pulled into the off-road park here, I had sort of pangs of a knife to a gunfight.
Yeah.
Because when you see the modified Wranglers and CJs with serious lifts and tires, I think there was a little bit of, this was the only Grand Cherokee on this event, and I think more people than just us were wondering how well it would handle.
What are you doing
yeah,
here with that?
Exactly.
I mean, it was the only Grand Cherokee that we saw at the Badlands, at the Jeep Jamboree, and it's just quite astonishing to see what it can actually do. But yeah, when you showed up and pulled in, everybody just, you could almost hear like the record scratch at the
yes,
bar or
yes.
the scene just kind of stops and everyone looks and goes, wait a minute, you're going to really wheel that thing?
Yeah.
And we did, and it works brilliantly. And I have to say, the 4xe silent motoring system is just fantastic.
It is, and I really preferred to do some of the serious obstacles in all electric mode. I would say that it is not 100% silent, though.
No.
You still hear, and there's a little bit of cognitive dissonance there because I'm hearing Jetsons like sounds, but we're doing Flintstones like stuff.
Yeah, I mean, it still has to have that low speed electric noise that it's required for any electric car, but it's still, I mean, frankly, when I'm wheeling through either one of these, either the Wrangler or the Grand Cherokee in electric mode, the loudest thing around is me.
And I like having a little bit of motor noise is helpful to know. It helps you kind of gauge how much accelerator pedal you're giving it, you know, when you need to climb over, get over an obstacle.
Exactly. So. And the thing is, it does have four-wheel drive systems like the Wrangler does, but it's a little bit different. In fact, that's what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to put it in to four low because we're out here amongst the dunes. So you got to shift it into neutral.
Yeah.
You push and hold the four low button. Good. Put it back in drive. Off you go. That kind of just illustrates, I think, my main difference between the Grand Cherokee and the Wrangler. And I liken it to a coffee analogy, a coffee maker analogy. The Wrangler is an espresso machine. You have to know exactly what you're doing in order to make something good out of it. You have to know what button to push, what lever to pull, what setting to put it in. You are the one responsible for going off-road, and the Grand Cherokee is not like that. The Grand Cherokee is like one of those all-in-one super fancy coffee machines. You put a cup in.
Point and shoot.
Yeah, you push a button, out pops a latte with the art on the top. It's super easy to do, but it's more just about knowing what setting you have to put it in and what kind of button to push as opposed to matching the vehicle up to the terrain. So it's still capable, it still does things, but it's not as much fun, I think, as the Wrangler.
And if you're a true coffee aficionado, you can tell the difference.
Yes.
And you want that level of customization that you get with the Wrangler.
Yep, exactly. The other advantage I think that the Wrangler has is that you can take the top and doors off, which is normally an advantage. Out here right now, it wasn't so much an advantage because it's dry and dusty as hell. And anytime we had the windows, just the windows open, the whole interior gets, you know, schmutzed up.
Yes, everything's sepia tone.
Yes, absolutely. But in other conditions, when the weather is conducive to that kind of thing, taking the top and doors off really is, there's no comparison.
Absolutely, and that's where the 4xe silence, relative silence, is even better because then you hear the crickets chirping and the crickets and the birds chirping and the environment all around you kind of adds to the experience.
When we're driving through that creek, you hear the water running past the stones and you don't hear the engine idling. I mean, it's a serene experience. It's really cool. It makes me really wonder what, you know, the future of off-roading is going to be like when everything's starting to go electric and it's just silent and quiet and
fully
you get to
in
enjoy
nature. Right.
The problem is for a lot of full electric off-roading, there's nowhere to charge. The infrastructure is still not caught up with normal electric vehicles. I can't imagine what it's going to be like trying to get things to rural areas to try and charge up off-road vehicles. That's going to be even more difficult.
Yeah, and at the entrance to this park, there's a couple, there's a Jeep Trailhead chargers, but those are not DC fast chargers.
Right.
And even to plug in these vehicles, it's really more time than we have to spare.
Exactly. You like wheeling? We like wheeling. So why don't you push that like, subscribe, and notifications button, and you'll know every single time Cars.com goes off-roading, either in Jeeps or in something else. The powertrain is the same between the two Jeeps. It's that turbocharged 2-liter four-cylinder engine matched up with an electric motor and a larger battery pack than most hybrids have because it's a plug-in hybrid. So it's making 375 horsepower and 470 pounds-feet of torque, which that's the Wrangler, and I think it's the same in the Grand Cherokee
as well.
You don't get the same electric efficiency out of the two of them. The Grand Cherokee has, I think, some 25 miles of all-electric range. The Wrangler gets something like 22. But I've been able to get much more out of them in electric range in both of those vehicles, just through some normal testing.
I don't feel that the 4xe plug-in hybrid powertrain is a particularly polished, refined sounding or feeling powertrain.
Yes.
And so in that respect, it feels a little more incongruous than in this otherwise luxurious Grand Cherokee versus being in a Wrangler Rubicon, which kind of feels like a farm implement to start with. That's part of its appeal.
Yeah.
So I think the Wrangler kind of wears the 4xe powertrain a little bit better than the Grand Cherokee in terms of your expectations of that vehicle, but the benefits are the same in both. Like, and that was one thing that I think we were both surprised by, is when we put it into e-save mode to run, use the gas engine to charge the battery, we were putting back a significant amount of charge in the battery that we were then able to use on obstacles that we encountered later in the day.
Yeah, we've got about, what, 9 or 10 miles of range in electric mode only when we were wheeling the Wrangler, and a little bit more than that in the Grand Cherokee. And then when you're off-road,
it was basically enough for us to spend the morning in electric mode, and by lunchtime we were spent.
But then you switch off between them, and then we were talking to a couple of other 4xe owners who had the same experience, is that once your batteries drain, you can put it in e-save mode between off-road obstacles and then put it in electric mode to actually do the obstacle, and it works brilliantly that way. Yeah, especially when you're going downhill. If you have it in a low gear, if you have it in like four low, and you just engage the electric drive, you don't need to shift down into first gear at all. You just let the electric motor brake torque you all the way down, and it works really, really well.
Yeah, smooth.
Yeah. So when we were testing the two side by side, we put them up pretty much the same obstacles the entire time. And the Grand Cherokee could do 90% of what the Wrangler could do. There was only one obstacle that we actually tried that the Grand Cherokee could not actually do, and that was a special climb up into a tube, basically a tunnel. But it didn't do it because it was wet, and the tires were wet.
Tires couldn't get traction. Rocks were wet.
Yep, and we couldn't get the rear axle to lock. Despite the fact that it says it has a locking rear axle, there's no button in here to lock it yourself. So it's just an automatic kind of thing. We couldn't necessarily get it to do it, so it didn't meet that expectation, but it did everything else we threw at it, mostly undamaged. I might have spontaneously restyled it just a little bit.
There might need to be a little replacement, remove and replace front fascia part in the future.
But overall, I mean, the capability of the thing is really astonishing. And it didn't just surprise us. It surprised everybody at the Jeep Jamboree.
I saw there were at least once I heard one of the trail guides kind of hang out after they were officially done with the obstacle, and they basically said, I want to see if that Trailhawk can do it. And I think they were pleasantly surprised as well.
Yeah. I mean, all of the Jeep guys who've been to a lot of their Jeep launch events knew that, yeah, the Grand Cherokee, there's a reason that there's a trail rated badge on the side of it. And not on every Grand Cherokee, not every Grand Cherokee has that trail rated badge. They actually test these things, and they make sure that that trail rated badge means that it can do the things that they're advertising, and it really can. And
right,
it's a capable off-road vehicle that's also a family vehicle.
And I think that's what really needs to be stressed, is the dual mode nature of this Grand Cherokee. Like I said, I drove it the better part of 3 hours coming down from Chicago, and it is comfortable and pleasant on the highway in a way that no Wrangler Rubicon can be.
Yeah, I drove the Wrangler Rubicon 4 hours down from Ann Arbor to this off-road park. I did not have quite the same pleasant, luxurious experience that you did.
Yes.
It's not nearly as bad as it used to be.
I mean, true.
Wranglers used to be serious farm implements. Now, they've been civilized quite a bit, but it's still louder, it's windier, it still has much looser steering because you've still got solid axles front and rear. You don't on a Grand Cherokee.
You're making lots of corrections, especially in crosswinds.
Yeah, it feels like you're piloting a sailboat down the highway. It can be an issue sometimes, but you get used to that. And the thing is, a lot of Wrangler owners just kind of go, it's the price of entry for this thing.
Exactly. And at this event, 98% of the vehicles here are Wranglers.
Yeah.
Or CJs of some sort.
And the other 2% basically was old Cherokee XJs.
Yep.
And us,
in the Grand Cherokee. The only one.
Yeah. The only one. But still successful in winning hearts and minds of Jeep enthusiasts who didn't think it could do what it could do.
Another thing that is a key advantage, at least of the vehicles we drove as equipped, and this raised my eyebrows, this Grand Cherokee, while certainly not cheap, was about, what, $8,000 cheaper than the Wrangler Rubicon. Now, granted, that has got like a $9,000 20th anniversary package, which has a lot of stickers and badges in addition to some functional things. So if you're more careful with the options sheet than these were, you can get a Wrangler Rubicon 4xe probably cheaper, but the way they were equipped, And again, for the dual mode nature of this Grand Cherokee, this strikes me as a lot better deal than the Wrangler Rubicon.
It does. And again, it really just comes down to, what are you going to do with it? You know, is it primarily your family hauler that you might want to take off to a campground somewhere? Yeah, then this would be a great choice, probably over a Wrangler. Or if you really are more about wheeling and you really like the idea of having a Four Seasons convertible with a top removable, doors removable, then the Wrangler really does make a better sense for that. Yeah, that's just kind of the dual nature of these things. It's not an apples to apples comparison. It really isn't. But then again, that's, I think, what Jeep's idea is, that they're providing something for everybody. You know, do you want the family car? Do you want the adventure off-roader? You know, you can have both, or you can have either or. We're going to be providing updates on our journey with this long-term Jeep Grand Cherokee all year long. And if you'd like to learn more, just look out for it here at Cars.com.